Welcome back. In earlier videos, we've looked at several important project agreements. We've seen how they fit together and what aspects are important to organize. The book sections that we've placed online will give you useful information on the characteristics of these agreements. In this video, I'd like to focus on the concession agreement. This agreement is part of nearly all public-private partnerships, and it provides the basis of cooperation between the private and the public party. In it, the public party gives a concession to the private party to undertake an infrastructure activity. Most likely, this infra activity was traditionally a government task, say the creation of a road or a prison. The concession agreement is an interesting agreement in that it tries to match the requirements of two very different stakeholders. The public party, that's the government, and the private party, which is mainly the project sponsor and the lenders. The government tends to focus on a very different objective than the private parties. The private parties will see the project as part of their commercial business. They'll expect to earn an acceptable return for all the work that they do and all the capital that they need to invest in the project. They are driven predominantly by financial motives. They apply financial analysis. The governments have a much broader outlook. They look at social and environmental benefits. These are benefits that are often difficult to quantify. How do you compute the value of lower CO2 emissions or poverty alleviation in a developing country? And even when we can compute the value, then we still face the problem that such benefits will arise to anyone, not only to the project investors. And then the financial investors will all but ignore these benefits. Why would they invest if everybody else benefits for free? The circles in this slide show how social and environmental benefits can occur in the outer two circles. In the outer circle, we find benefits of which the value cannot be quantified. An example is poverty alleviation. The middle circle, for benefits that can be quantified, but they arise to everybody. For example, the benefit of reducing traffic jams if a road is widened. That benefit goes to everyone who uses the road, not only to the project sponsor. Governments will focus on all benefits, including those in the outer circles. Private parties tend to look predominantly at the inner circle, the circle that contains the actual project cash flows. If we want to make a project attractive for public and private stakeholders, we need to offer each what they need. We need to offer private parties acceptable cash flows and public parties maximum social and environmental benefits. And this is exactly what the concession agreement is designed to do. Satisfying the private parties is relatively straightforward. We need the project to generate acceptable cash flows for them to make the returns that they seek. Satisfying the public stakeholders and maximizing the social and environmental benefits is trickier to achieve. When it has released its concession, the government needs to leave the project to be run by the private parties. They are the ones who need to strive towards maximum social and environmental benefits, even where they are not naturally motivated to do so. Let me give you an example. If a PPP road project needs to be closed for maintenance, the public party prefers that to be done at night when disruption to the traffic is low. On the other hand, the private party prefers not to have to work at night. That will cost more in overtime for road workers. Here's another example. A private consortium builds a ministry building. The government will be the tenant, and it will pay rent for a period of time. This rent is the project revenue. The government wants the building to be equipped with low emission LED lighting, and other measures to reduce the power consumption and the CO2 emissions. But installing that is more expensive for the private party. It will increase the project cost and reduce its financial return. So how do we give the private parties a motivation to strive to maximize the social and environmental benefits? Stop this video a moment to think about that. It's clear from the above that we need to actively steer the private parties towards optimizing for maximum social and environmental value. A government can do that by writing into the concession agreement conditions that force the private parties to take social and environmental matters into consideration. The government will need to define beforehand what social and environmental objectives it wants the project to achieve. And these must be measurable objectives that must be met by the project company. And only private parties who can deliver these objectives will be entitled to a concession. When different companies tender for the concession, the government needs to define appropriate selection criteria. These selection criteria should include social and environmental ones, not only the financial criteria. Then the government can weigh the best tendering party according to its full ambitions. And that is indeed what they do. Thereafter, there needs to be an ongoing assessment of the project's success to make sure that the project company delivers on all that it promised. And in all three circles, not only the financial objectives. Sometimes the concession agreement provides a payment by the government for the use of the project asset, say, the road. That opens the possibility of a fee incentive. The project company will want to maximize the concession fee that it receives. The level of the concession fee may be set to depend on achieving social and environmental objectives. If the road PPP can conduct maintenance with a minimal road disruption, the project company may get a bonus fee. If the energy consumption of a building, ministry building, is below a certain agreed threshold, the rent may increase. Or reverse, if the energy consumption is higher than acceptable, then the rate that the project company gets may be reduced. PPP transactions have been operating for many years, and over the years, governments have learned a lot about creating the right kind of incentives in the concession agreements. In this way, they can achieve what they want. Concession agreements can be quite detailed and descriptive because of such provisions, but they help to make the PPP a natural extension of government policy. In all these considerations, we need to keep in mind the requirements of the project investors and lenders. They will require predictable cash flows, as we know. If a concession agreement contains the chance of a bonus, they'll probably not complain. That's more cash flows for them. But if there is the possibility of a penalty for poor social or environmental conduct, that's likely to complicate the financing. The chances are that the project lenders will assume the worst. They will assume a maximum penalty or the lowest fee income. And then they will check if the project loan can still be repaid. For example, they will look if, in such circumstances, the debt service cover ratio is still comfortably above the minimum threshold that has been defined in the facilities agreement. That's all I wanted to say about the concession agreement. You can read more about the existing alternatives in the course book. Thank you all for your attention. Let's practice now. There'll be some exercises after this video. Thanks again for listening.